victory over death. He raised him up to live forever. He left behind his linen wrappings, the shroud, his grave clothes. Robed in white, Christ leads us from darkness to light. Help us to follow him, leaving behind the things of our past that obscure our horizons. We dedicate these offerings as tokens of the breaking dawn of Christ. May our gratitude shine forth by joyfully giving of our earthly goods. Amen. You may be seated.
It's now time for the children's moment, so if the children would come join us up front. He did what was humanly impossible, and that was he died and then he rose from the dead. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? And because he's Jesus and because he's God, and he said that he was going to come back, and that's how he showed that he was the Son of God. That's how he did it, Ty, because he's the Son of God. And so then he did that so that we would not have to die for our sins. Because do you think Miss Jennifer makes mistakes? I do. I know some of you see that. Reed says I make. He's right now on tape. But do you make mistakes sometimes? Right. So we don't have to worry about dying for our sins because Jesus did it for us, and we just have to love Jesus and love everyone else, and that is how we thank him. Is we live our lives for. And today is a big day because it's exciting. Are you excited? Yes. Yes, it's very exciting. So what we're going to do is on the count of three, we're going to yell as loud as we can, hallelujah. You think you can do that? Can you count to three? Okay, here we go. One, two, three. Hallelujah! That's great. I love it. Okay, anybody want to pray for us today? Well, let's see. Okay, we'll let Olivia pray.
Thank you for the day. I love you and like you and amen.
Our hymn medley is listed there in your bulletin. We will sing together the first verse of each one of these hymns. And as you're able, please.
Thank you.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. You can find this in your new Bible or on the back of your order of worship. Now, I should remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in return received, in which you also stand, through which also you have been saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance that I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to someone untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you. lesson this morning is going to come from Mark's Gospel. From Mark chapter 16, we're going to read Mark 16 verses 1 through 8. And I invite you to stand as you are able, in body or in spirit, for the reading of our Gospel this morning. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him being Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us at the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side. They were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. And there you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And all they had been commanded them, they told briefly to those around Peter. And afterwards, Jesus himself sent out through them from east to west the sacred and imperishable proclamation of eternal salvation. This is the word of God, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. This sermon takes a tremendous amount of willpower for me right now. You don't understand really the amount of willpower that is taking me to preach right now. Because it's Easter, which, as Jennifer said, is a big deal. It's the Super Bowl for us as Christians. I mean, Easter, it's why we do church on Sunday. I mean, back in the Old Testament, they had church, they had synagogue or temple from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. That was the Old Testament Sabbath. But as Christians, we transition the Sabbath to Sunday. Because every Sunday we gather together, we worship, we celebrate the resurrection. That's why we are Sunday people, is because of the resurrection. So every Sunday we gather together is a little Easter. Every time we Christians come together, we proclaim the resurrection. So, yes, it's Sunday, and yes, it's Easter, but it's also April Fool's Day. You know, and I wanted my sermon to be, Jesus comes out and goes, "April Fool's Day." My wife suggested that was a bad idea. As you all know, she's the smart one. Also, someone else had the great idea. I could make my sermon today an homage to the Doobie Brothers song, "What a Fool Believes." But I decided not to do that either. But I love big Easter. I mean, I love the excitement of Easter. I love doing big things on Easter. And so I didn't do any of that, but the biggest thing, I really feel like I need to apologize to y'all this morning, because, I mean, this robe doesn't do justice to my sports coat this morning. Jesus said, "Don't hide the light under a bushel." So I really feel like I should preach the rest of my sermon like this. It's not to be cocky, but I look good, y'all. I mean, this looks good on me, Jim. I mean, after service, there'll be two lines, one to the right to take pictures of the flower cross and the lilies, one to the left to take pictures with me. So the line will be in, following worship, and we'll make those dreams come true. So I like big on Easter. I mean, I like doing big. We've choice people through social media and through worship to invite, to bring their friends here, to have this be a great day. So if you're one of our guests today, so honored that you've chosen to be with us today here on Easter. I love Easter. I was doing some preparation for the sermon, and if you want to really enjoy yourself this afternoon, go home and Google the phrase "Easter fails," because there are some churches that tried some really big things on Easter that didn't work, and they were pretty funny. One of which, a preacher was going to, it's all on YouTube, because everything's on YouTube nowadays.
The preacher was going to preach a sermon about Jesus coming out from the grave, and he put a casket on the stage with him. So he got in the casket, he closed the door, and it fell over. Another, a church, was doing like a passion play, and they have this, the pivotal scene where Jesus comes out of the tomb, and they have like these sparklers that start shooting off. It looks awesome until it catches the set on fire. And you hadn't lived if you've seen deacons run down the aisle with fire extinguisher, putting out Jesus because he's on fire. That was pretty awesome. And then another one I saw was another passion play where they were nailing Jesus to the cross and they got him up and he fell down. So, Easter is a big deal. And churches have always tried to go big. I've tried to really get folks to know the miracle and the power of the resurrection. I mean, it's what we do. It's what we're about. We are an Easter people. That is what we are. That is the very core of what we are as Christians. From the earliest of days in the church, we have worshiped on Sundays. We've gathered on Sundays. We have proclaimed the resurrection. He is risen. He is risen indeed. This is what we're about. This is the core of our faith, that death has been overcome, that sin has been defeated, that hope springs eternal, that Jesus Christ is not dead, but even now is seated at the right hand of the Father. And through him, he has overcome death, and we have overcome death through him as well. We are not a people of defeat. We are a people of victory. That is who we are as Christians. In church, we got to believe that, y'all. But right now, the world doesn't, does it? So I believe this stuff. I tell people, I got a problem. I believe it. I believe he shall return and make all things right. I believe in redemption and resurrection and hope and forgiveness and peace and grace. These aren't just words that I say because I'm a preacher. I say them because I believe them. He is risen. That's who we are. So, I love big Easters. But no Easter, obviously, can compete with the first. You know, we always read from different Easter, the different accounts in Scripture. And I love y'all. I love the Bible. I love God's Word. It's so beautiful. It imparts such truth and such wisdom. It's such our guide for life. And it's just so precious. John Wesley said it's doubly blessed. It's blessed when it was written, and it's blessed when it's read. This one said it contains all things needful for salvation, and everything needful for salvation is made plain to men. God reveals himself to us through this holy book. But I love, we read the different accounts from the Gospels, because every Gospel writer kind of gives its own little things that he noticed that are so beautiful and so unique. Sometimes kind of funny. I like John's Gospel, John's account that we find in John 20. It's funny because John always refers to himself in the Gospel as the disciple whom Jesus loved. So, in John's Gospel, it tells about how the disciple whom Jesus loved arrived at the tomb before Peter, and then he waited for Peter to come inside. Okay, I'll see what John did there? He said, okay, y'all, I'm faster than Peter. I beat him. And I put this in the Bible so everybody knows that I'm faster than Peter. First humble brag of Peter, he was John. Just so y'all know, for all eternity, I beat him in a foot race. Just want that clear. So, John does that in his Gospel. But Mark's Gospel does something very interesting to me. We see it. How Mark starts off. It has, we read the verse 8, it continues on the rest of the chapter. The original, Mark originally wrote to 8, and then he kind of came back later and added the rest of it. But I love what it says there. It says this, that the women left with terror and amazement. What a beautiful phrase. They left beaten. They saw him abused. They saw him forsaken. They saw him forgotten. They witnessed and heard with their own eyes what happened to Jesus. He was dead. D-E-D, dead. He was done. He was dead as a doornail. And you're welcome. That's right. That had been the first service. So, I know. So, he was dead. completely and utterly. And so they go to the tomb to anoint him, to anoint the man that had saved them, who had restored them, who had given them life, who had believed in them when no one else believed in them, who had given them hope when they had no hope, who had restored their life, restored everything about them. They approach this tomb with broken hearts because this one who loved them is dead. And they get there, and he's not there. He's gone. And they hear an angel that tells them, go. Go and tell folks about this. And they leave with terror and amazement because this does not happen. But sin has been defeated. The grave has been defeated. Vainly death saw his prey. Could not contain him. Vainly death forbids him rise. It cannot contain him. He rolled away the stone and came out alive. And that just does not happen. And they were terrified. Because they had seen the great enemy defeated. That's our enemy, y'all. Sin, death, and the grave. And they have now seen with their own eyes the back of the serpent broken. They have now seen sin, death, and the grave lose its power. They have now seen death overcome. And so they were just amazed at the power of Jesus. When was the last time you felt like that? When was the last time you felt amazed in the presence of Jesus? I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he can love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. We've got to recapture our amazement in Jesus. We've got to recapture our love and our passion for the power of Jesus. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be worried. We don't have to be tossed aside because we read the back of the book. We know who wins. Like the great theologians of Bogus, you'll say, I ain't scared. I know who's going to win. So look what the angel did, though. Told him. Said, go to the disciples and to Peter. Why did Peter get his own shout out? What did he do to deserve that? Well, let's hit rewind. Let's go back to Thursday night. Let's go back to Good Thursday, Monday, Thursday. Jesus is there with the disciples. He tells them, okay, guys, Peter, by the time the rooster crows, you will have denied me three times. He says, no, it's not going to happen. I trust you. I'm going to stand with you, Jesus. I'm not going to deny you. I will never deny you. Never happen. I'm not going to deny you, Jesus. By the time the rooster crows, three times. So they go to where Jesus is being held. They're warming themselves on fire. So they come up to Jesus, to Peter, and says, hey, you're one of his, aren't you? No, I'm not one of his. I don't know the man. I don't know what you're talking about. Later, someone else comes up to him and says, hey, you're one of his disciples. Not just do you know him, but to follow him. He says, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know who died. You lost your mind. I ain't from around here. I don't know what you're talking about. One time, Peter, do you know him? No, I don't know the man. I don't know him. How many times do I have to tell you? I don't know that man. Rooster crows. Scripture says this. Scripture says that Peter went and wept bitterly. Three times, Peter had the chance to stand up for Jesus. Three times, Peter had the chance to claim him as his Lord. Three times, Peter had the chance to defend the honor of the man who saved him. And not once, not twice, but three times, Peter failed. three times publicly before God and everybody, Peter denied knowing Jesus. We focus on Judas the most. The two folks denied him. Judas and Peter. So now the angel tells the women, go to his disciples and Peter. And tell them that he is risen. Why is Peter singled out? Because the Lord wants Peter to know he's still part of the family. The Lord wants Peter to know that, yeah, he messed up, and yeah, he was wrong, and yes, he was failed, but he is forgiven. And he is not cast aside, and he is not forgotten, and he is not forsaken, but he is still the Lord's. No matter how great the sin, no matter how big the failure, no matter how awful it may seem, Jesus still says to Peter, you are mine. And I loved you, and I called you, and I will not forsake you. Even though you have messed up, you are still mine. That is one of the miracles of Easter, is that the Lord looked at Peter's failure and says, my death and my resurrection has overcome your failure. You are forgiven. Friends, today, you are forgiven. No matter what you've done in your life, it's not bigger than the resurrection. No matter what you've done in your life, it is not bigger than the blood of Christ. No matter what you've done in your life, it is not greater than the all-amazing grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You are forgiven. And the Lord desires to give you his grace and restore you to wholeness. Because that's what who he is. See, but here's the thing. Jesus, too, is not the only one that must be exited this morning. Because sometimes we lock ourselves in our own tombs, don't we? We roll the stone over our hearts. And we stay encased in our tomb of shame. We stay encased in our tomb of unforgiveness. We stay encased in our tomb of hatred. We stay encased in our tomb of hurt. And sometimes we stay in our own tombs. In church, we've got to come out of our tomb and come out into the light and know that we are loved and that we are forgiven and we do not have to stay in tomb forever. But the stone has been rolled away. Not just the stone of Jesus' resurrection, but the stone of your resurrection. You have been raised with him. You have been restored with him. And you can be whole with him even now. Some of us don't feel that way this morning, do we? Some of us are locked in our tombs right now. Some of us are brokenhearted over hurt and loss in our family. Some of us feel pain over death. Some of us feel hurt because of the church. Some of us feel a whole mixture of things. What I'm telling you, friends, is that no matter what you're feeling now, Jesus' grace is bigger. Jesus' love is bigger. Jesus' redemption is bigger. We are a resurrection. And we are a people of life and of love and of hope and of grace. You are forgiven. Come out of your tomb. Feel the power of the grace of God. So we see the reason why Peter gets mentioned. And then what it says, go on, tell them to go out. And proclaim this message of eternal salvation. So here's if one miracle is the fact that Peter is restored and forgiveness happens, here's the other miracle. It wasn't just that Peter was restored and forgiven. It was that God had a plan for Peter. Because what happened to old Peter? On Pentecost Sunday, Peter preached a sermon where thousands of folks got saved. God was not done with Peter. God had a plan for Peter. God loves you. God desires to forgive you. God desires to restore you. And God has a plan for you right now. You were made for something amazing. You were made to be used by God. You were put here on this earth for some divine reason and purpose. And you are where you are right now for some reason that you may not know and you may not understand and that might not make sense. And you might not like where you are. You might want to be a thousand different places. But God has you here in this moment for something big. He has a plan for you. It isn't just that he redeems you. It's that he's going to use you. Of all the people in creation, God has something for you that only you can do. The very God that created the stars in the heavens. The very God that took breath of dirt and breathed into the breath of life. The very God that formed the Grand Canyon and the beauties of creation is the same God that his loving hand formed you as well. Not only are you forgiven, but you are precious in his sight. And there is something that you and you alone can do. That's the second miracle of Easter. Not just that the Lord forgave Peter, but the Lord was going to use Peter. So is it for us, friends? You are loved. Oh my gosh. You are loved more than your mind can fathom. God loves you more than you can even think about. And God wants to use you. God used these women to proclaim the gospel. They used Peter. He used Paul. Paul, who, as he said, as we heard in the first reading, persecuted the church, killed Christians, was awful. And God used him for this mission. Right now, if life's not making sense, everything's fine. If it's only making sense, you're just not content. Do you not too forgiven? Do you really, in your heart of hearts, in the very core of your being, know that the Christ of Easter has forgiven you? Do you know that God has a plan for you? Are you living it out? Of all the things of creation, those beautiful things God made was you. He desires to save you and forgive you and use you. Because that's who he is. That's the miracle of Easter. May we live in that miraculous power all the days of our life. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your love, which knows no end. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your resurrection. God, let us know now the depth of your love for us and the power that comes from you. We love you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Likes to go in his office with you.